Get ready and start your engines for our 6th Annual Aviation Month on Savvy Business Radio with some of the top experts in the aviation community. Our guest today is co-founder Dave Hall of MotoArt.com, a company devoted to transforming decommissioned airplane parts into functional art and furniture. Dave shares details into the creation of MotoArt.com. They took a unique approach and idea and turned it into a very successful business. Find out more at MotoArt.com. Hi, Dave. Welcome to Savvy Business Radio for our 6th Annual Aviation Month. Welcome.
Well, thank you. Thank you for having me. Fun to talk to you.
Oh, my God. You bet. You are from MotoArt. MotoArt.com. You create amazing pieces of furniture that are very useful for either the home office, which is mostly what you guys do, and also some home pieces and office pieces that you've created over the years. Now, I first came across your amazing work at Lockheed Martin, actually. They have a wonderful conference table that you built out of a C-130 airplane, the flap, actually. And I was there and I said, who built this? I've never seen anything like it. So you've taken bits of decommissioned airplanes and built them into amazing pieces of art. What brought you into creating MotoArt and doing this sort of thing?
Well, thank you for the questions. You know, the Lockheed Martin installation was, a very proud moment for us to actually get one of our art pieces right into the corporate headquarters of Lockheed. Mm-hmm. Those C-130 flaps that you saw for the mm-hmm. conference table, we found those back in Tucson, Arizona, back in 2001, when we very first started this company. We just mm-hmm. started around the same time as 9/11. Mm-hmm. And when we started MotoArt, we actually, before MotoArt, to kind of give you a backup, we were in the high-end sign manufacturers for like Disneyland and Universal Studios. And, mm-hmm. and then we rolled in, found an old scrap aluminum propeller, and it took off from there. But mm-hmm. the flaps, it was one of the first stops we ever did, because back in Tucson, Arizona, back then, mm-hmm. The laws had just changed where Homeland Security jumped in and made it off limits to be able to really purchase any military parts. Mm. And that includes the C-130s. Mm. And so what happened before is a lot of these, they would auction off the planes and little miniature boneyards set up around Tucson. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the military parts got grandfathered in. So we were very fortunate that we were able to get our hands on these C-130 parts. Mm-hmm. And of course, a very big, first big client we had was Lockheed Martin, who heard that we had them, and we built mm-hmm. them this conference table.
Wow. Now, how did that come about? Are you primarily both you and, are you both artists, or are you aviation enthusiasts? How did that come about that you decided to take aviation pieces and create artwork with them?
Yeah, it's always an interesting question. People like, how did you start this and why? You know, I always say, what little boy doesn't fly around the room with his arms out and pretend he's flying? And I think mm-hmm. that's true in a lot of us, that we just have a fascination with flight.
Yeah.
And as a kid, building models and hanging from the ceilings. And funny enough, both mm-hmm. my partner and I don't fly. I mean, I've flown plenty of times, but we just yeah. don't have a pilot's license. And, nor do many of our clients, many of our clients don't fly.
Yeah.
And, I think there's just that, fascination with flight that really draws people, the audience that we sell to. Yeah. And, so mm-hmm. we went from being a sales and marketing guy and and just having a creative eye and, mm-hmm. and never taking an art lesson in our life and kind of starting this whole thing called MotoArt. And it's funny, today we actually give art lectures at schools and universities. And then that we neither both my partner and I have never taken an art lesson. So, uh-huh. I think a lot of luck and a lot of passion is what drove this company. And it's been 17 years now since we've been doing it.
Wow. And that's so inspirational, Dave, because I got started doing what I'm doing with you right now, which is broadcasting 5 and a half, almost 6 years ago, and I have no broadcasting experience, have not gone to school for it. I'm an accountant for the past 26, 27 years. And, you know, numbers, I do them well, but I love this a heck of a lot more, and I love aviation as well. And you make a good point there that most aviation month has become one of our biggest months, and the reason I even started it the first year we came on air was that my partner's a pilot, and we fly everywhere, and I have this fascination myself of flying. So I decided, let's mix business and aviation, and it turned out to be our highest peak month as far as listenership the very first year and every year afterward. And it's right. I think even if you're a boy or a girl, maybe you don't want to get out there and fly the plane yourself, but you're interested and curious about the whole mystique of flying in itself.
Right, right. Yeah. And that's who our audience is. You know, our audience are production companies or advertising firms or, you know, law firms or doctor offices. And there's nothing to do with flight, you know. They just love, you know, they're gravitated towards the engineering. They actually want to build the pieces. I mean, you know, that's who the true heroes are, the people who built this stuff. We're just trying to kind of give it a second life and a spin and polish it up and make it look, you know, better than museum quality. And that's what makes it pop, you know. It's just the work that goes into it.
Yeah, and you get to have a piece of history in your life. I mean, whether it's an old World War II bird that you're able to restore and make into a beautiful piece of furniture, or even a decommissioned commercial liner, it's a piece of history that you have within your possession.
Right, right. Every piece tells a story. And let me tell you, it is extremely hard to find these old vintage airframes. I mean, what's one of the beautiful things that MotoArt has done in the last 17 years is we've obtained a pretty large collection of airframes. And you know, my boneyard is probably bigger than most boneyards at this point.
Wow.
It's just of all the stuff that we've collected over the years. And versus whether it's World War II or a jumbo 747 that we're dealing with, it all tells a story, every single piece that we build.
Yeah, and I've seen that from witnessing the pieces that I've seen online and also in person, that it reveals a remarkable story. But I want to speak a little bit to when you got started with this and had the aha moment, or maybe it was several moments where you decided to start this business. A lot of the people who listen in to Savvy are older, either say middle age and older bunch, who maybe decide to start a second career. And sometimes you start things and do a career that you wouldn't have expected, like you and your friend, and bam, it turns out to be something that works and is beyond working. It's quite successful. Was there any time in the beginning where people were trying to tell you, hey, this is crazy, you know, let's do something more normal? How did it work out for you in the beginning?
Gosh, it was a very rocky beginning. You know, what we had was just, of course, a hobby. There was no moto art. We actually called ourselves propeller art, and that's how it all started. Mm-hmm. My partner and I worked together at a previous business, and one day the scrap aluminum guy came by and he had a beat up propeller, and my partner Donovan, you know, rescued it basically, and just like, hey, you can't scrap this. This is history behind this. And of course, I thought he was crazy. I'm like, there's a freaking propeller, you know? And he pulled his propeller out and spent like 80 hours re-sanding it down the whole substrate and mirror polishing it. And he put it up and made a sculpture out of it. And it took me back. I'm like, wow, that is stunning. And so, you know, he went to the Rose Bowl swap meet and sold it for like $1,000. He came back. I'm like, Donovan, you lost money on that. He's like, what are you talking about? I'm like, you spent 80 hours on that thing. And he was just so happy to sell it for $1,000. So, gosh, this is so long ago. So then I'm like, let's go do a show. You know, hey, I'll finance the tab. And we'll go 50-50 and we'll go to a show. So we picked the Barrett Jackson car auction show in Scottsdale, Arizona. And that was in 2001. And so we took these beautiful propellers that Donovan had created. And we went there, and, you know, I was still kind of on the fence. I knew it was beautiful, but was it marketable, right? That's the big question. Was it marketable? And as we got there, these propellers were like human lures. I mean, they were so mirror polished and sparkling, and we had base lights on them. We had, you know, at least 10 deep people trying to get around these sculptures during the busy days at Bear Jackson. And I'm up there pitching them. And you know, it wasn't the fact that we sold every single one of them for really good money. Mm-hmm. It was the enthusiasm that mm-hmm. I saw in everyone's eyes on what we were doing. And that's what really sparked MotoArt. You know, I walked away from that show going, wow, we're on to something. Mm-hmm. And so quickly, Dom and I went to breakfast one morning, and they just on a napkin, mm-hmm. you know, let's take a wing and make a desk out of it. Let's take a galley cart, make a little bar. Let's, and on and on and on. And we're at a coffee table, and we're brainstorming all the different things we can do. So we literally marched out to shortest boneyard mm-hmm. Away from us. It was Rancho Mirage. And the guy kept calling me kid and son, you ain't never going to make a living off selling airplane parts. I'm like, I'll show you. I will make a living off selling airplane parts. And so we came back and we basically bought a couple things and away we went. And really what sparked it was mm-hmm. While this is all going on, mm-hmm. we still had our day job. And our day job was these big signs that we were doing for the theme parks. Mm-hmm. And I'm sitting there waiting for the crane to arrive to do an installation. And I'm reading, you know, mind you, it was back in 2001, a Maxim magazine. And I'm sure you guys know Maxim. And back then mm-hmm. it was the world's largest men's publication that was, millions being circulated every month. Mm-hmm. And in the very back of Maxim magazine, they had like what's hot and what's new. And I said, what do you bet these guys would love these propeller sculptures and what we're doing? So I went and spent some money and photographed a couple concepts that we had. And I took the top 8 editors of Maxim magazine. And I sent them all a press kit with a DVD with all their images on it and pictures. I was trying to create water cooler talk, right?
Yeah.
And I'll be darned, I didn't get a call from the senior editor of Maxim magazine about a week later. And said, Dave, this stuff is beautiful. What else can you do? And of course, I'm just rambling on all the different concepts that we have. He's like, great. Be in New York in 2 months. And we'll give you 2 pages. We'll make you basically the centerfold of the September issue of Maxim. And I thought my heart leaped out of my chest. and that's what happened. Donovan and I, we rolled up our truck. We went to New York. They bring all these models out. Them all over the art pieces, and we were the centerfold of Maxim magazine for September 2002. Mm-hmm. Lucy Liu was on the cover, and then it was just like a firecracker. We had Men's Journal called, Architectural Digest called, and within a very short time, 50 publications within the first 2 years of business that were writing about our work, and then eventually Discovery Channel signed us, and we were one of the first earlier reality TV shows. We had a show called Wing Nuts on Discovery Channel back in 2003-2004.
Mm-hmm.
Now, so that's how it started.
That is
a very long version.
That's amazing, Dave. That's amazing. Now, when you got the call from Maxim, and he said, "Hey, you're rattling off all the things that you, all your concepts. Did you have them built yet, or did you get off the phone?
No.
And go, oh crap, we got to build these.
Yeah."
Oh
God, no! It was mostly concepts. We had a couple things. I had enough to capture their attention when they opened that submittal. Everything else, and I was rattling off like a bomb table and a wing desk. We had not built those yet, so we marched out. We had basically 2 months to get ready, and we went out and bought a bunch of stuff, and we stocked them together. So everything you see in that edition were first. In fact, the galley cart, now you see them everywhere. People are. I swear to God, we inspire a lot of people out there. You see a lot of our designs all over the world now that other people are doing. But when we first introduced that galley cart bar, we had a sound system in it. We had battery packs in it so you can walk around. Had a built-in ice cooler. Mm. And we used to go to the Reno Air Races back in God, way back when. And Dom and I would tour the pits. After hours and give all the flight crews free drinks, and we'd be blasting Austin Powers, and it was fun. That was way back when. basically screaming, kicking, hollering for anyone to recognize it.
Yeah.
That was what we did.
Well, it didn't look like it took that long, Dave, but what I'm pulling from your story that's really inspirational for anyone listening in, maybe someone who just has a fabulous idea that can see the demand that hasn't gotten started yet, but what I hear behind your story is, you took action, you had a great idea, you took action, you saw the demand, you took the action, and then when the opportunity presents itself, you got into high gear and you guys made it happen.
Right. With no budget. I mean, that was the thing. You had no money. So we learned the trick that what we were producing, this beautiful art that we were producing, was eye candy. And we quickly recognized that. So we just kept producing and networking our artwork. And by, you know, back then, these publications were starving for good content. Mm-hmm. And that's really what ignited MotoArt. Today, I mean, mm-hmm. not to go forward 17 years, today we're located here in Los Angeles. We've got a dozen employees. We work out of about 18,000 square feet. And MotoArt can be found in 70 countries around the world. I mean, we ship all over the world now.
Wow. And
yeah.
Well, that's just a tremendous story from where you came, and not, I mean, 17 years is not a little bit of time. I think that's one thing I always try to press into anyone listening in who maybe is a newbie business owner. Anything great does not happen overnight. Even what you've created, which is amazing, even within the first couple of years, now it's 17 years out of the gate, and you guys are just still kicking. Where do you see yourself going in the next several years? What's the big plan?
Well, you know, you know, we're still have some great designs. I mean, there's still at least, you know, 15 designs up our sleeve that we haven't really worked on yet. But interesting enough, I came up with something about a year ago, and I'm sure a lot of your viewers have probably seen it online already. We called something called Plane Tags, and it was something I created for Christmas a year and a half ago for Christmas. Mm-hmm. And it quickly took off. And what we were doing for Plane Tags is we were taking the skins off these aircrafts and making luggage tags out of them. And we put the tail number on it, the history of the aircraft and the schematic. And they started selling like hotcakes for us. And every month now we've been debuting a brand new plane that you can buy the skin off of, and then it's a little form of a luggage tag. Yeah. And we have about 30 planes now that we represent. And today we did a UH-1B Huey helicopter where we had 1,000 tags made off this you know, Vietnam helicopter. And they do really well. People all over the world buy them. Go on.
I was just going to say that's really great for anyone listening, because I've seen a lot of your furniture, and some of it, as you've mentioned before, it's kind of pricey. I mean, this is custom artwork. This isn't just furniture that's practical for your office or home. It's also artwork. So it does cost, but you have the tags, which are affordable for anyone who wants to have a piece of aviation history.
Right. That's what was amazing to me. You know, I've been representing all this high-end furniture, and I'd be the first to tell you, I couldn't afford my own stuff. I mean, we make desks that are like, you know, $10,000, $15,000, $20,000, all the way up to $30,000 we've made desks for. Mm-hmm. You know, and it just blows my mind, the people who buy these. The tags, mm-hmm. when I introduced the tags, I couldn't believe it. You know, here we had this fan base of building and building and building, and I rolled out this, you know, $20 plane tag. It certainly took flight. And, you know, now our plane tags go from anywhere from $20 to $125. And mm-hmm. we kind of price them out like we do our furniture, mm-hmm. based on the rarity of the aircraft. Yeah. The $125 tag, just to tell everyone, is the very first B-1B bomber ever made. Wow. Number one. Yeah, they tore it down in Texas back in the 80s, and somehow the cockpit ended up in back on the East Coast, and mm-hmm. I got the cockpit shroud and I cut it out and was able to make 1,000 tags off of it. There's nothing left of the aircraft.
Wow.
But it has all the documentation to it, which is really interesting. Mm-hmm.
And that's one thing for everyone listening in, the amazingness of your artwork is that this isn't just art. This is really, you didn't just go out there and pretend to make airplanes parts that look like airplane parts that aren't. These are the actual airplane parts that you created artwork and furniture from. So you are definitely getting a piece of history there. Now, of all the pieces you've built, is there any piece or maybe several pieces that have really stood out as being your absolute favorite that you've created so far?
Well, that's a tough one. We've had so many unique stories about our customers and the ones that we made. I think that the biggest pat on the back I've had was we made Ripley's Believe It or Not this year. Ooh, yes. Yeah, for one of our conference tables. I thought that was fun. But, you know, it just... It's so hard to narrow down a particular story. It's been such an adventure. You know, I just last week, I mean, mm-hmm. give you a slice of my life. We We picked up a PBY Catalina out of the Pima Air Museum, Pima Air Museum in Tucson. Basically donated. We bartered for some work from the museum, but got a 1942 PBY, and it was just the carcass of it. The museum had bought three PBYs, and they took all the good ones, all the good stuff out, made one good PBY. So they were left with these carcasses of the PBY, which was perfect for what we do because they can't restore it. It's never going to fly. And we basically went out and rescued it. So we had a crane and low bed truck and a film crew. We went out to Arizona, loaded up this big PBY Catalina and shipped it to our yard out in Mojave. And it's stuff like that that just doesn't make it really a job. It's like you love what you do by rescuing these aircraft. We got a kind of a unique aircraft we're going to be introducing in about 2 weeks. I'm not sure if you really want to hear it or ready for it, but you want to hear what it is?
Yes, absolutely. Yes.
We have Donald Trump's Boeing 727, business jet that he had that before he bought his 757 that he toured with this for the nomination for the presidency. But this is his first business jet that all four kids were raised on. They had toy boxes on. It's completely documented. Even the paint scheme, everything's still the same. And we found that. And, we had the opportunity. So we're introducing the line, of course, of tags. Oh. And we got a money clip line coming out.
That's going to be hot.
Skin off of it. So why not? Well, we thought it'd be fun for the holidays. Whether you love them or hate them, we'll have that Republican friend in our
life. Now you know what to get that Republican friend in your life.
Right. MotoArt. I'll call it the 45.
That's right.
Use Trump's name. Number 45, money clip.
Oh,
skin off his Boeing 727, where we basically laser etch the specifications of where it came from under the money clip. So we thought that was fun.
I'm getting me one of those.
All the tags, by the way, just to tell you, all the artwork is on MotoArt.com.
Yes.
But all the tags that we do, we have a whole separate website. It's called PlainTags.com. And you'll go on there, and there's all sorts of different aircraft from, the Flying Bananas, the B-1B, B-17s,
awesome.
24s, B-25s. We even have the Gimli glider, the plane that before the Miracle on Hudson was the Gimli glider. So we have that aircraft as well. So lots of fun historical aircraft on PlainTags.com.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. And I see on MotoArt.com, you have on the top there, plane tag store. So if you end up on that site,
you go.
Yeah.
Boom.
Yeah.
Click right into it.
Yeah, absolutely. Now you mentioned Mojave. Do you actually build the stuff in the desert in a big like studio? And then this, what we see online is where you just showcase the art?
No. We have a yard in Mojave. We just have, it's just, we have about an acre of land out there that we share with all the big boys, all the 747s.
Nice.
So we go out there, there's just a fleet of 747s, and in between them is a little fence yard with all of our inventory in it.
Nice.
So we have about an acre land up there filled with airframes. We're located in El Segundo. We have been there for about 8 years. Unfortunately, we just lost our building. They tripled the rent because we became a victim of our own success. So the neighborhood just took off. So we're going back to Torrance. I think we're going to be landing on Western Avenue in Torrance. So we're going to be making that move this quarter here. So a lot of moving targets, as I say, going on this quarter.
So do you see either you or Donovan ever going to get your pilot license, or are you just going to chill and ride with other people?
I got my children signed up for it.
Awesome. They can fly you everywhere.
Yeah, my son is anxious to become a pilot.
That's great.
He just turned 16, and that was we're talking about that being his Christmas present. If he keeps up his grades, he's going to be able to get his flight license. Here's my thing. I'm a little bit of a daredevil, always been. I've broken at least a dozen bones in my body. I'm fine being on the ground. I'm fine being that guy in the back seat. I love my friends who fly. Yeah. I got a lot of friends who fly, and I'm okay where I'm at. I mean, I trust me. I've flown a little. I like it, but I like what I do.
Yeah, I get it. And now, before we end out, if any business owners listening in, or maybe not even a business owner, but they have, like you did, they have a passion and they want to get out there and start a business, what would be your number one tip to anyone out there? If they're in the shoes you were in back when you started.
You know, that leap of faith, right? We all got to take that leap of faith. Mm. You know, my whole thing is, man, you can never give up. Never give up. You know, you end up just living it 24/7. And some of my best stuff comes up when I'm just alone away from the office about what I'm designing next or what I'm going to try to find. So, just never give up. Just keep going for it.
Absolutely. Well, this has been such a fascinating talk, and I'm so blessed you were able to come join us for our 6th Annual Aviation Month and share your great wisdom and your awesome artwork, which everyone has to go check out at motoart.com, and get your tags today at plaintag.com, is it?
Plain tags, plural.
Plaintags.com. So I want to thank you again, Dave, for coming to share your great wisdom today on Savvy Business Radio.
It was fun. Thank you very much.
You betcha.